So good afternoon to August gathering. Permit me to inaugurate the short-term training program titled Research and Innovation Using Technology, scheduled during 22nd, that is today, till 29th April 2021. Saraswati Mahabhage Vidhye Kamal Lochane Vidya Rupe Vishalakshi Vidyam Dehi Namostute. O great goddess Saraswati, the lotus-eyed personified knowledge, O goddess with large eyes taking the form of whole universe, bless me with your knowledge. I salute you. With the prayer and with these words, we instigate the inaugural session of this short-term training program titled Research and Innovation Using Technology, जिसे हम हिंदी में ये कह सकते हैं के शोध एवं नवीनीकरण के लिए जो आज के परिवेश में जो तकनीकी सुविधाएं हमें उपलब्ध हैं उसके ऊपर ये छोटा सा एक ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम किया गया है जिसके माध्यम से जो हमारे शोधार्थी हैं जो रिसर्च स्कॉलर्स हैं दे विल डेफिनेटली गेट एन इनसाइट ऑन हाउ टू यूज दिस टेक्नोलॉजी एफिशिएंटली एंड इफेक्टिवली टू सपोर्ट द रिसर्च एंड इनोवेशन प्रोसेस. For this, we are indeed blessed to have the benign presence of Honorable Vice Chancellor Rabindranath Tagore University, PTA sir. We also have the benign presence of Professor Dr. Rajan Velukar sir, the Vice Chancellor from Aurora University, Surat. And we also have the benign presence of Professor Ravindra Rena sir, Professor of Economics, NWU, Mahikan, South Africa, all the way from South Africa. And thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation at such a short notice. Thank you for your, you can say, kind support and kind presence in this inaugural session, sir. Sir is here in the capacity of keynote speaker. We also have Dr. P.K. Jain, sir, Principal Hamidia Arts and Commerce College. I think very soon, sir, will join us, or maybe sir have joined us right away, because little bit technical glitches facing from sir side. So Dr. Deepti Maheshwari is coordinating with sir. With this, we also have the all the eminent speakers today with us who will be taking subsequently these sessions during these 7 days. To begin with, Dr. Kavita Indapurkar, Dr. S.K. Pathak, Dr. Srishti Chauhan, Dr. Rajendra Gupta, sir, Mr. Chandrasekhar Vittal, sir. I extend a hearty welcome to all the eminent speakers, and we will be giving their brief introduction subsequently in the coming up sessions. I welcome to all the eminent speakers, and I express sincere gratitude in the beginning itself to accept our invitation to be with us on this platform. Welcome to all. I also extend welcome to all the respected deans who have joined us today, all the coordinators and conveners of this short-term training program, and most important, the dear participants. Participants includes research scholars across nation. Participant includes teachers, teaching fraternity across nation. A big welcome to all of you, and thanks for being with us on this program. When we talk about this short-term training program, I, being a IQAC coordinator, Dr. Sangeeta Johari, Dean, Faculty of Humanities and Liberal Arts, thinks always about to give the facility to the research scholars, to the emerging researchers, to give them the insight about the research and the innovation, and give them the pathway how to go about the same. If we recall our time, I think I'll take Monica ma'am and other people who are on board. We were really faced a lot of problems when we actually get into the research. But as an academician, now it's our moral responsibility to proceed further and to support the emerging research fraternity, including the academicians and the budding research scholars, to support the ecosystem, to support with the ecosystem with which they will be able to do the meaningful research, I must say, and will be able to bring out certain innovation in their research with the help of the technology. So conceiving this idea, the Faculty of Humanities and Liberal Arts, Faculty of Commerce, Faculty of Management, IIC RNTU supported by MHRD, in collaboration with Aurora University Surat and Hamidia Arts and Commerce College Bhopal, have taken this initiative to proceed with this 7 days short-term training program. I hope these 7 days will turn out to be the productive days for all the participants who have shown their trust on us and who have joined this program. And they will definitely get to know the new dimensions, because as I always say, research is a continuous process. and every time when you attain something new, you get into the something new which so far you are not aware about. So with this, I will be proceeding further with the words of wisdom session. And I just want to confirm from Dr. Deepti ma'am's side that is PK Jain sir is with us, madam? Dr. Deepti Maheshwari, madam.
Join ho gaya hun, PK Jain. Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. So I'll be beginning with the words of wisdom of the principal, Dr. PK Jain sir. It has always been great to have kind words from our senior before the formal beginning of any kind of program. So in this regard, we are indeed blessed to have the all the senior officials with us to bless us for this training program. To begin with, I request Dr. PK Jain sir, principal, Hamidia Arts and Commerce College, Bhopal, to share his words of wisdom. Before sir proceed, permit me to share the very few credentials, because I know all these eminent personalities have big things to share with, but seeing the paucity of time, permit me to share a very brief profile of Dr. PK Jain sir. Dr. PK Jain sir is having the enriched experience of 41 years, 12 international research papers so far, more than 13 books on accounts, management, communication. Sir is the recipient of Lakshman Singh God Puruskar, Best Professor of Commerce by the Higher Education Department of Madhya Pradesh. Sir has been also the recipient of Best Writer, Dr. Shankar Dayal Sharma Srijan Samman, Best Principal Award for the higher Education by the Higher Education Department of Madhya Pradesh. Sir has also supported NSS in a big way and has also given guidance to the number of scholars into his credit. I request sir to please share his words of wisdom on this occasion. Sir, please.
I, on behalf of Government Hamidia Arts and Commerce College, Bhopal, extend a warm welcome to all of you at a week-long webinar series on short-time training program on research and innovation using technology. On this inaugural session, I find immense pleasure in welcoming our respected Dr. Brahm Prakash Bethia, Vice Chancellor, Rabindranath Tagore University, Professor Rajan Belurkar, RO University, Surat, Professor Rabindra Raina, keynote speaker today from South Africa. We hope that this webinar would help the participants, especially the research scholar, to expand their mental horizons and broaden their perspectives. Thank you. So much, Dr. Bethia sir, Vice Chancellor R&TU, for joining us for in organizing Government Hamidia College also. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words. Moving further now, I extend a request to the Honorable Vice Chancellor Brahm Prakash Bethia sir, Rabindranath Tagore University. Sir has served with IFM as in the capacity of director, and also sir was associated as a professor with IRMA. So far we know and we have interacted with sir. Sir is really having the great efficiency to coordinate the things and to support the ecosystem, both in the academic as well as in the administrative way. With his guidance, we are now really touching upon the new horizons of research, and he is really laying a lot of thrust upon the quality parameters so far the research is concerned. So we are indeed blessed to have sir guidance, and today on this occasion, I request sir to please share his words of wisdom. Sir, please.
Okay. Thank you. Professor Ravindra Rana ji, Professor of Economics, NW, from South Africa. We welcome you, sir. Rajan Velukar from Aero University, Surat, is with us. Dr. PK Jain, sir, is with us. From the Hamidia Arts and Commerce College, Bhopal. Madam Sangeeta Johri, the Dean, Faculty of Humanities and Liberal Arts. She is also the coordinator of she's also working with IQAC. We welcome on the behalf of RNTU again, on this SARTER program, which is Research and Innovation Using Technology. I was just wondering when this topic came to me, and then I have to speak, what to speak. Thinking who are the organizers, and one of the organizers was our Institutions Innovation Council. There's some idea which has cropped up to me that I will just share with you, how this research and innovations, they can use the technology as such. Technology, it is basically radically, it has altered the human civilization. And adoption is increasing almost in every exponential pace. Whether it is appliances or anything, the technology is there. When we think the higher education, they have similarly been affected by the increasing accessibility to technology. Even all primary schools with the English medium. So what are the hottest technological innovations which are give us certain kind of innovations, or they can give some kind of applied uses as intelligence, because it is a coming age, and basically when I was reading some time back Economic Times, their heavy investment few years, if you read the last month's Forbes, 80% of the enterprises are now investing in the an AI for expanding the investments. So that is what is coming at to age as such when we talk about the artificial intelligence. Internet, sometime when we're talking about the speed, the internet was become a sometime lacuna when we are downloading the colored photographs, etc. But when we look at the human beings, their appetite is never satisfied. They always want to go faster and faster, connections readily available, pushing the technology forward as such. The size of data is increasing every day. So the internet connections is basically pushing the technology forward. If that choice is given, the human being wants the speed of the internet as a lightning speed. So this is just around the corner, because once the idea has come, or we have to enhance the speed, it is going to be with a lightning speed, and you will see it within a year or two, our internet will be working with a lightning speed as such, because of transformative, and many aspects are there which we have to live with it as such. When we look into the other aspects of technology, things are there with a life enriching smart technology as such, which is will change the home, the room, or you enter your premises, automatically light will switch on because the sensors are there. Now when you go to the kitchen, number of appliances will be ready for you. So the life enriching smart technology is been changing every day as such, and they are already entered in our life at home as such. When we talk about the even home entertainment systems, they are changing the way in which we are socializing. Our physical meeting one-to-one has already gone away. Everything is on virtual. We just talk to on a video call and we are satisfied. Our emotions are satisfied. So we are losing the emotions to the mechanical things. If I want to and then satisfy myself emotionally also, okay, I have seen my mother, I have seen my father. So these are the certain changes on these things. It is better or worse, that's a question every individual has to look into it. emotions are more important, or that about it everywhere the robots are there, they have already come and they are going to interfere in our life very soon as indeed, but they will be replacing human beings. They don't have any kind of emotions. So incredible opportunity, and with a far more flexibility in automation using maybe possible to program the robot to figure out how to grasp something by looking at it in the future. Now, when I have to interface, either I have to assess or I have to touch my mouse or I have to touch the pad of the computer, means, but now you will mind it, you remember my words, the day is not far when our brain will directly interface with the computer. You think over it and the things will be done. Ho sakta hai ki mere lifetime mein hi aapko dekhne mil jaye. So the thing, the rate which is moving is ki how we can, our brain can have an interaction with the controlling device of the. There are, I was going through one of the medical booklet some time back, and we are talking about the organs. So they see, if I want certain organs, particularly the pancreas, will be free from the sugar problems as such. So the technology will be monitored by the all these our interaction with the computer as such, ki which place it has to go. So these all little medical devices, artificial intelligence, are on the way as such. And our medical scene will change. The cancer, which is, seems to be non-treatable, that will be treatable as such. Technologies called innovations are there as such. Now, since the IIC is a partner in organizing this webinar, when I went to IIC in our own in the 3D printing, which otherwise I have never seen earlier anywhere else, but in our own I have seen the 3D. Now that gives an idea ki why not the human organs can be come done when we know it is possible to replicate the human organs. So why not can we go for the human organs manufactured using the 3D technology, etc. And the day is not far, because 3D metal printing. Now will the soon you will say the 3D organs are available, and artificial, because these are certain things which is possible in future. So there will be a amalgamation of AI with the, which is still lacking, but the day is not far when this will be having interface between biological things as such. So you can have the artificial embryos, no doubt about it. So available everywhere. So then the things which we are already using, like we are talking about big data and analytics, we talking about cloud computing, this will be a past days. Right now these are the upcoming areas, but very soon you'll find the people forget about machine learning, forget about the cloud computing, which are the right area which is a future as such. So number of things will be coming, right? It, we have to kill the animals. Future will be there when even the meat will be manufactured using the AI technology, 3D these things, and then you don't have to kill the animals, and you will have the same taste of the meat using the this 3D technology as such, because pancreas for 3D is a pancreas, so everybody can be free from the sugar problems, etc. So there are certain literatures which have started coming in, so the day is not very far. Could eventually be lead to a viable transplants. So the technology is going to replace the defunct human organs, could one of the applications as such. So this is a very interesting topic to discuss, ki how technology can change our world or what are the scopes. So I congratulate all the organizers ki they have thought a very good topic, all the areas as such. I have just mention certain extremes which may not be feasible, but at least it will churn your mind. It will make you think whether it is possible or not. Have used something which is related to the human being, human organs. It may not be necessary that everything which I have said may be possible. We are using about technology, when we are talking about the innovations, how it can be used for research, medical research, or it can go in other innovative areas as such. So once again, I very much for inviting me to share my thoughts, and I wish a success for this your 1 week program on this research and innovations using technology, and I hope you will research and will come up certain things which we have might have never heard about it, and it may be just a thinking process of future. So all the best. Thank you very much for inviting me. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for your kind words and deep insights on these emerging technologies and how these things are really changing or transforming. This is really a point to think upon and to ponder upon, and that is why we have organized this program, so that we can develop or we can share that how this technology intervention can actually give the information, how this information can be assessed, and how the researchers can proceed further. So thank you, sir. Thank you for your kind words. Moving further, we have with us Professor Dr. Rajan Belukar, the Vice Chancellor from Aro University, Surat. Before I invite sir for sharing his words of wisdom on this occasion, permit me to share brief credentials of sir. Dr. Rajan Belukar sir has more than 36 years of experience with Indian higher education system as a teacher, development leader, quality innovator, technology adopter, administrator, and policy advisor. Sir has held various positions, vice chancellorship at various institutes of eminence. To name here the few is University of Mumbai, Raisoni University, Chindwara, IC Vice Chancellor, SNTT Women's University. He also served as a Senior Program Officer, Commonwealth Secretariat, CYP, Asia Region, Deputy Secretary to the Governor of Maharashtra for a span of an year. Sir has also worked on various important committees of National Knowledge Commission, UGC, NEC, Film and Television Institute of India, Central Government, State Government, USA, and various important educational institutes. So far, sir has conceptualized and edited 3 books, Gandhi at the Rate 150, Nirbhaya, Ek Atmachintan, Words of Wisdom. Sir has also visited several countries, USA, UK, China, and many more in various capacity and in various role. Rabindranath Tagore University is really feeling privileged to have the benign presence of Rajan sir. Now, sir, we are requesting you to share your kind words on this occasion. Sir, please.
Thank you very much, Sangeeta, for inviting me to speak a few words on, I'm sorry, this was the sound of ambulance. I'm in Mumbai and then the several ambulance will be going here and there. The situation good. Am I audible?
Yes, you're quite audible.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Perfectly.
So, thank you very much, Dr. Sangeeta. I must compliment the Rabindranath Tagore University, Bhopal, the Hamidiya Arts and Commerce College, Bhopal, and the Aurobindo University, Surat, and Surat, and IIC of RNTU for organizing a conference, short-term training program on research and innovation using technology. When I read the title of the training program, that is Research and Innovation Using Technology, that is the most important word which you have written, so I must compliment all of you. Because the word using is better than intervention of the technology. So you are not emphasizing on the technology, but you are emphasizing on using it for the betterment of the society. And therefore, I must compliment all of you in choosing the topic, apt topic for this training program. Basically, when we understand what the universities are established for. So basically, the universities are one of the major contributors of scientific research leading to invention and innovation in the world. Now, all the universities, when they are doing research, they are creating some new knowledge. And therefore, the universities not only prepare the labor force, they create the much needed skilled human resource, which is needed in any given situation like this pandemic. If you see in this pandemic, a lot of scientists from across the world, from various universities came together. And within a period of 1 year or maybe less than 1 year, they came out with a vaccine. Now this vaccine, they came out, it is giving some kind of result. And that is the role of the university research. That is what the university and research laboratories are doing. And therefore, we must appreciate them also when we are discussing this topic in this training program. Friends, now we are basically talking about humanities, management, commerce, liberal arts, and how do we use the technology? I know the entire world is talking about blockchain, entire world is talking about artificial intelligence, entire world is talking about the humanoid and several things. There are two sides of technology. How to use this technology depends on us, depends on the humanity, depends on the human sciences. Disciplines depend on the social sciences discipline. What is the approach this kind of disciplines are taking towards solving the problems of the society? That is very, very important. And therefore, don't think that because of the technological interventions, because of the technological inventions and innovations, the humanities and social sciences and liberal arts, management and commerce has taken a backseat. In fact, if you tell me, if I tell you that this has taken a front seat in today's world, and therefore when IBM is doing a research, they are talking about three things. One is known, which everybody knows, and therefore solutions also known by everybody. Second is unknown. Again, that also we have acquired the knowledge of solving the problems which we were facing because of known unknowns to a large extent. But the third thing is unknown unknowns that we don't know. We don't know what is happening. And then how do we use this technology through artificial intelligence, through blockchain, even in economics, we don't know what is going to happen with these bitcoins. There is totally a confusion. The bitcoin can create a situation like 2008 or maybe 100 times more than that. The whole economy will be collapsed. in that Bitcoin, if somebody says, you know, the money doesn't belong to anybody. So what kind of technology which we can bring in so that whatever with that cryptocurrency is going to happen, whatever challenges which we are going to face, we should be able to resolve those. And therefore, what kind of technological intervention which we need, that we need to understand. Today also, if you really understand, during this pandemic, thousands and thousands of old people who do not have anybody, and during lockdown also, if no help is coming from outside, you can understand their situation. I read an article in 2003. And in that article, they had written that Japan has created one robot, one dog. And the robot is there inside that dog. And then further when I read, they said the dog has been created for the people, those who are living in the house alone, those who do not have anybody. So what that does, what that dog, the dog has to be trained. Like we train the real dog. So that robot has been created so that the owner can train him what needs to be done. If there is a bell on the door, then the dog should go first look outside who's there, ask the name, and after asking the name, come back, ask the owner whether I should open the door or not, and then the dog goes and then they open the door. That kind of training which can be given to a robot, and then the robot dog can act as it is. Is it useful? Yes, it is useful. And therefore, we need to understand the technology from that perspective, and we need to do innovation from that perspective. But can the humanities, social sciences, liberal arts, commerce and management alone can do it? The answer is no. And if the answer is no, then what is the solution? The solution is we need to break the walls which has been created between science and humanities. We don't interact with each other. Unless and until we interact with other disciplines, we cannot take our disciplines further ahead. And therefore, when the technology has come in, we need to understand other discipline. We need to understand the perspective of other discipline. I tell you one story. Data is very, very important. Even in human sciences and liberal arts, the data speaks the most. If you have the data, then you are the king. If you do not have the data, you are not the king. And that data can take you to innovation. Data can give you the future trends. Data can tell you the heartbeats, the rhythm of your heart, and then you can come out with a solution. And therefore, friends, we need to go beyond our own discipline. Disciplines doesn't exist today between two or more disciplines. Secondly, technology is not only computers. Technology is many things. Now, we need to talk about that technology which will be helpful to every individual. It is not helpful to take away the jobs of people. Gandhi also gave a technology. So Gandhi's technology was charkha. Now that charkha had gone to every individual house. And then they used to spin their own clothes. And that gave solution to the nation to a large extent. And therefore, when we are talking about technology, we need not talk only that technology which is computer related. There are several other technologies which these farmers need. Don't create a technology which will take the jobs of thousands and thousands of people. But can you create a technology which will be useful for a small farmer having 1 acre of land or 2 acres of land, or technology which is going to help an individual household like Dharavi? in every household there are entrepreneurs. Can we create a technology for them? As Rahul Rohatgi has created one technology. That technology is a small device like a mobile. You can have your ECG at home only. In case of emergency, you can put that device at 6 different places in your chest and you get an ECG. There is one other boy who was graduating who created a eye testing machine. He came to Dharavi and he technology which he has created to test your eye, he went there and he sat at one place and he announced that you can come and test your eye. Nobody came. Then he asked people, why are you not coming? They said, if we come to you and spend a lot of time, then we will lose our labor. We'll lose our wages and we will not be able to survive for that particular day. We don't have time. And therefore, he had gone back and again reinvented. And then that machine which he created, the device which he has created, you just put it before your eyes and within a minute it gives the reading and the testing is over. We need to talk about that technology, which we need to talk about the technology which has been created in the North American state. That is one of the country, they can tell you by understanding the behavioral data that after 7 days, there may be disturbances or riot may take place in this part of the country. And therefore, now you can take care so that the riots may not take place or disturbance may not occur. So that kind of behavioral data they are collecting. But to understand that, you need to marry with the technology people. You need to understand what artificial intelligence is. You need to understand what are the mathematical and statistical models needs to be created. That is the kind of technology which the humanities and social sciences needs to understand. Now, what is human sciences? In human sciences, as psychology is involved, the biology is also involved. If you don't understand biology, there is no use of understanding psychology. If you don't understand mathematics, there is no use of understanding psychology. There is no use of understanding philosophy. If you don't understand commerce, there is no use of your invention or innovation, whatever you have come out of. You need to understand management. You know, day before yesterday only, I was talking how the government of India and government, state governments have failed. You know, we teach in economics. We teach in management. What do we teach? We teach the most productive class in any country is between 15 to 45 age group. If the most productive class is between the 15 to 45 age group, then any country must take care of this age group first. If the most productive class is going to survive, the nation is going to survive. That is what Australia and like countries, those who do not have young population, they are suffering. They are calling people from outside the country. If you are young people, send it to our country. So if your young people are not safe, if your productive class is not safe, then how can your nation be productive? And therefore, we must have taken most care of the 15 years to 45 years of age group so that we could have given them vaccine first so that they could have gone out and in the industry or wherever and participated in the production process and became a most productive country during this pandemic so that we would not have faced any economical
Hello.
I think there is some.
Ma'am. There is some technical glitch on sir side. That's what I was looking for. Ma'am, so, please could you make a call, sir? So I think there is some little bit technical glitch. So Monika ma'am is trying to resolve that. Meanwhile, I have an announcement for all the dear participants. It is in webinar mode. So the participants at the end of the first session, expert session, they can put up their queries into the chat box because of the maintaining the web policy and also to maintain the decor of the system. We have kept it on webinar mode. So all the dear researchers, don't feel any hitch in sharing any questions after the first expert session. This is the inaugural session is going on. So research scholars and academic fraternity, you can share your questions.
Sangeeta ji, sir is reconnecting. I think there was a technical problem.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. Yeah, waiting. Yeah. Meanwhile, I was taking the advantage of the time and I was making certain announcements.
He was almost done, but I think he's left with his
closing. No, ma'am. Yeah. Concluding remarks needs to be.
Yeah.
Sir is back. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So anyway, I was just finishing, but I was talking about the three universities as you have come together for organizing this event. All these three institutions can come together and do some joint project. And that is the need of the hour. So that if we can do some joint project, which is scalable, which will help the policymakers, that needs to be done. And that is the role of the universities. And we need to do a research which is impactful, which will impact. Like we can take a project which will change million people's life. So can we create a model which can tell how can we, whom we should first give the vaccination? I'm just giving an example, but there can be many more projects which you people can think and then come out with. But for that, we need to create a ecosystem. And then there are three kinds of ecosystem which we should look at it from. One is the university system. We, at the university level, we have one ecosystem. And that ecosystem is where we are talking about human capital, we're talking about governance capital, we're talking about physical capital, we're talking about intellectual capital, and we are talking about the financial capital. This is the university research system. There is another research system, and that is nothing but the stakeholder view of research system, ecosystem. So stakeholders, what is the stakeholders view of research ecosystem is in which the faculty is involved, the doctoral students are involved, research associates are involved, postgraduate students are involved, external institutes are involved, industry is involved, central government and other funding agencies are involved. So this is the stakeholders' view of the research ecosystem. And the third ecosystem, which is the most important ecosystem, that is the sustainable research ecosystem. And that is a sustainable research ecosystem which we need to create in our universities, where the national, regional, and institutional goal is very, very important. Whatever we are doing, we should link it with the international and national and regional goal. We need to understand what is the disturbance regime, what has disturbed us. That is the second thing which we need to understand. The third is research. Resource management and the knowledge management is very, very important. The fourth is research stakeholders, those who are doing, whether they are in the laboratory or in the university, but what for? We need to do it for society. We need to create a global research community. We need to create a global research culture. The culture is very, very important. Only teaching is not going to help. At the same time, time is very, very important. Say earlier, the vaccines used to come out of 10 years or 15 years. but our scientists have made it possible within a year. Whatever the efficacy is, but they have come out within a year. And therefore, time is also important. And therefore, we need to understand how do we create a research ecosystem which is sustainable. That is what I think I can, within a short period of time, I can talk about the research ecosystem. With this, I must thank all of you for giving me an opportunity for speaking in front of such a large gathering. At the same time, whatever I spoke, we are trying to do all these things in our Aro University. Thank you. Thank you very much, and my best wishes to all of you.
Thank you, sir. In fact, sir, it is our privilege to have the learnings and to have the insights from the from your side and from the Vice Chancellor Rabindranath Tagore University. Because again, I'll quickly recall, I'm saying like when we were doing research, we were really short of the guidance, short of the, you can say, the pathways. And now the research scholars, whether they are from your university or from any other university per se, or from our Rabindranath Tagore University, I think they all should feel that they are really indeed blessed to have such an ecosystem wherein the vice chancellors are coming and they are interacting with them and they are giving them the insights. रिसर्च के वो सही मायने उन्हें बताए जाते हैं स्कॉलर्स को. शुरुआत का जो 6 months कोर्स वर्क का जो पीरियड होता है उसमें ये बताया जाता है कि हाउ यू गो फॉर द रिसर्च, व्हाट ऑल इज ओपन फॉर यू. सर, यू हैव राइटली सेड इट इज यूजिंग टेक्नोलॉजी, बिकॉज रिसेंट टाइम्स वी आर रियली हैविंग अ लॉट ऑफ डिबेट ऑन इट, दैट लाइक वेदर द टेक्नोलॉजी ओवर पावर अस और वेदर देयर इज रियली अ नीड ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी इन द ह्यूमन sciences or the liberal arts. But yes, now everything is interrelated, and you rightly said that it is a time of transdisciplinary research. And I sure that I think I'll discuss with Monica ma'am and other teachers, and surely we will be looking forward for some workable project further, because yes, the real research is that research which can have some meaning to transform the lives at any level, maybe not at the big level, but at the small level. So definitely, sir, we'll try for that. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your kind words and kind wishes. Moving further, now we have already entered into the research arena. This inaugural session itself is one of the very important session, because herein we have got such a nice intellect who have really spent their entire life in the research, and they have a deep insight. So moving further with this, as I said in the beginning of the session, we have the presence, we have the benign presence of Professor Ravindra Raina sir, who is today will be delivering his keynote session on the relevance of research and innovation using technology. And before sir proceed further with his session, permit me, sir is really enriched with a big profile, but I must say, and I have taken a very few points from his profile so that to aware our participants about his credentials and how far he has gone through his research journey. So Professor Dr. Ravindra Raina is a profound academician and distinguished scholar in economics, writer, editor, advisor, motivational speaker, and public intellectual with over 29 years of teaching and research experience in Asia, Pacific, Africa, and European continents. He has been an independent consultant and training expert. Professor Raina is currently working as Professor of Economics at the NWO Business School, Northwest University, South Africa. He also served as an adjunct professor of economics for master's and doctorate program at Monarch Business School, Monarch University, Hagendren, Zug, Switzerland. Sir has received various awards and accolades, to name few, like he got the prestigious award of the best researcher in the year 2011 from Nambia University of Science and Technology, and also the recipient of award Man of the Year 2012 by American Biographic Institute, USA. He is the founding editor-in-chief of the International Journal of Education, Economics and Development, and associate editor of the African Journal of Science, Technology, Innovation and Development, which are IBSS and Scopus Index Journal published by InterScience UK and Taylor & Francis UK respectively. As of March 2021, if we see, the author's rank is 5776 in SSRN, H-index 19, I-10 index 34. Such research areas mainly include the rural entrepreneurship, globalization and higher education, WTO, clean technology, and sustainable development. So far, sir has given guidance to a number of research scholars, and I must say that those scholars must be blessed to have the guide like Rana sir, because in person, as a person, if I say, sir is very kind and very active and very eager to share his knowledge with the budding researchers so that they should also come forward with some innovation in the future. So, sir, it's over to you. Please guide us and enlighten us.
Hello. Good evening or good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, here it's good evening, sir. There it's good afternoon.
That's right. Yes. Well, it is indeed a great privilege and honor for me to be part of this international webinar. I must thank the organizers of the Rabindranath Tagore University, Bhopal, and also Aura University, Surat, India. And I must acknowledge the presence of our Honorable Vice Chancellors, Professor Brahma Prakashji, the Vice Chancellor of Rabindranath Tagore University, and Honorable Vice Chancellor Rajan Velukarji, the Vice Chancellor of Aura University. And I must also thank Dr. Sangeeta for putting all the efforts to bring me in on this particular event, and all other colleagues, deans, directors, and other learned colleagues who are sitting here on this platform. It is an important day for us today. It is an Earth Day, where we need to save the Earth collectively and with all our efforts and endeavors. If we save the Earth, then Earth also will save us. So ladies and gentlemen, the topic that has been chosen for this particular 1 week faculty development program is very important, short-term research and innovation using the technology. So if you look at the technology, technology has become one of the important factors in our lives. Without technology, our life become almost impossible. So meaning that technology is connecting us, is trying to uniting us, yes, is also trying to amplify us and also empower us. So because of the technology, I'm sitting here in South Africa, and you are all sitting in India, in different corners of India, Mumbai to Bhopal, Bhopal to Delhi, and so on. But we can always see each other, talk to each other, listen to each other. So thanks goes to the technology. In fact, that is uniting us together today. So that is an important topic. We would like to discuss some pertinent issues in the interest of time that I would like to touch upon only some of the key issues here. The key issue here is that we got the developed world one side and developing countries on the other side. The developed world, which spend huge amount of money on the research and development. America remains the largest economy in the world today. For the past 150 years down the line, starting from 1871 until today, America is the largest economy in the world. Now, why America is the largest economy? It is with the research. If you look at the top rated researchers, most of those researchers, top 10 researchers in the world, 8 of them from America alone, ladies and gentlemen. So that speaks about America. And meaning that if you look at per million, America has got 331 million population today. And out of that 331 million population, for every million population, they got the average number of 4,700 researchers. And how much money they spend? They spend more than $500 billion on the research. $500 billion is not even the economic size of many countries in the world, particularly from African countries. Many countries, they don't even have $2 billion or $5 billion as the national income per annum. So if that is the case, America could able to spend more than $500 billion. And the per capita expenditure, if you look at, on an average, they spend $2,000 per person, whether they are doing research or not doing research, but per capita expenditure on the research and development by America is $2,000. Now, which country is the second country that can spend more money on research development? It is none other than Germany. Germany become the fourth largest economy because of the fact that on innovation, the research and development, they are very strong enough. They got the strong industries. They could able to spend probably $1,600 per capita expenditure on the research alone. And then we have the Japan. Japan used to be the second largest economy in the world for more than 30 years until 2010. Now that was taken over by China. So Japan spent about $1,400 today per capita expenditure on the research. And whereas China, being the second largest economy in the world, it spends about $370 per capita. So they got about 1.4 billion people, and then they spend on an average about $370. Whereas when it comes to India, being the fifth largest economy, how much money we spend? We spend less than $100, ladies and gentlemen. So look at China spend about 3.5 times more than us. America spends probably more than 20 times more than us. And Germany and Japan also spend about 14 to 16 times more than us. So this is where we are standing. If you look at the total population of this world today, ladies and gentlemen, we got about 7.8 billion people living on this planet. And how many researchers that we have today? We got only 7.8 million researchers, ladies and gentlemen, across the globe, 7.8 million researchers. So meaning that we got the number of researchers is only 0.1%. So we need the researchers. The researchers sitting here, they are aimed to complete their PhD programs. They are aimed to complete, probably they have the PhD degrees and they want to have maybe publish some articles, good articles in good journals and get promotion like professor, associate professor, and so on and so forth. So this is our ambition. There is a wrong notion, ladies and gentlemen, that whenever we look at PhD, people begin to make a fun out of PhD. They say that it's a permanent head damage. It's not permanent head damage, ladies and gentlemen. You must think that permanent head development. So all the scholars who are sitting here, please try to think that it is a permanent head development that you need to uphold. You need to uplift yourself that you could be one of the credible researchers in this world, not only in India. Now, when we look at the Indian population today, we got close to 1.38 billion people living here. We are very much close to 1.4 billion people, ladies and gentlemen. Now, how many researchers that we have in our country? We got only 140 researchers for every 1 million people living in our country, ladies and gentlemen. That is a quite least number. And we got even Philippines. They got more than 380 people. If we go to many other countries in the world, they have more than us. So as I said to you just now, we have America, which got 4,700 researchers for every million people. So we need to increase the number of researchers. Research is not to just complete your PhD, get the fancy title of doctor, and you call yourself as a doctor. And that is not enough, ladies and gentlemen. That is the responsibility on each and every one of us will increase when you get the doctorate degree. And we must commit ourselves. We must try to, it is a honest job. It is a dedicated job. It's a laborious job. We all should be committed to do some credible research. We remember that when we look at the leaders one side and the scholars on the other side, who is known in this world? A leader is known only in geographical territory, whereas the scholar is known in the rest of the world, ladies and gentlemen. So you must remember that today we remember about Einstein. Einstein got Nobel Prize in 1921. And we remember him. He passed away in 1955. We still remember him. We always talk about his E is equal to MC squared and so on, because he's a scholar. And we also remember that Marie Curie, who got the first Nobel Prize. She was the first lady to receive the Nobel Prize in physics in 1903, just 2 years after the Nobel Prize was launched in 1901. And then she is the only lady got two Nobel Prizes until today, that she also got another Nobel Prize in 1911 in chemistry. So we are talking about Marie Curie, and because she's a scholar. We are talking about Rabindranath Tagore ji, that who got the first Nobel Prize in Asian continent for his book called Gitanjali in 1913, about 180 years ago. So we talk about all these stalwarts. If we talk about our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji, if you go to South Africa, in any of the small towns in South Africa, and go and ask who is the leader of India or who is the Prime Minister of India, probably they don't know. And if I ask all the people sitting here in this platform, if I ask who is the President of South Africa, probably 80% people they don't know is Cyril Ramaphosa. And if we ask a German Chancellor, and nobody knows across the globe. So the leaders are known only in their geographical territories. Probably the neighboring countries people they know, but not everybody knows about them. Whereas the scholar, on the other hand, known in the world. So that is why we know about Shakespeare. That's why we know about Albert Einstein. That's why we know about Charles Darwin. And we have got Tesla, Nikola Tesla, and so many other stalwarts that we have, Sir Arthur Newton, and so on and so, Galileo, and so on and so forth. So these are the top researchers in the world. They passed away many years ago, but we still remember them today because of the fact their contributions. Ladies and gentlemen, we must also remember that historically, if you go back, King Ashoka is famous for us. And we have Maurya dynasty, we have Chola dynasty, we got so many dynasties. But how many people that they remember Ashoka today? How many people remember Aryabhatta today? So we must compare and contrast. So meaning that a scholar is known in the world. The scholar life is much longer. Even physically, we will be living here on this planet only between the age of about 50 to 100 years time. But the scholarly contribution that you make, that will always make you alive, ladies and gentlemen. We got the Nobel laureate Samartya Kumar Sen, who got Nobel Prize in Economics. He was the first economist from Asian continent to receive the Economics Nobel Prize in 1998. And how many citations, Google citations that he has, ladies and gentlemen, he has got 3,50,000 citations. So that speaks about his scholarly contributions. So if we have lots of prime ministers for the past, Indira Gandhi was there, Rajiv Gandhi was there, Nehru was there, and so many other prime ministers were there. I mean, prime ministers come and go after 5 years' time, but how many prime ministers that we remember? So that is the kind of leverage, that is the kind of recognition that we need to give for the research, ladies and gentlemen. In the interest of time, that I would like to thank, I'd like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. And we must encourage the researchers, because 140 researchers for every 1 million people is very, very lower number. Even at least on an average, every country to maintain the sustainability, to establish some kind of framework where the number of researchers for every million should be more than 500 ladies and gentlemen, according to the international standards that were being set up. So in order for us to promote our researchers from 140 to 500, how much time that we need to spend? We've been producing lots of students across India. We got almost 220 million students who are studying in different educational institutions in the country, but we are unable to produce the researchers, ladies and gentlemen. So we must focus on that. A researcher is always more worthy than producing a teacher. A teacher can be teaching the students, and a teacher can be remembered by only that particular generation. But whereas the researcher can be remembered by many generations. Aryabhatta died long time ago, thousands of years ago. But we remember Aryabhatta, we remember Manusmriti, who was the first probably father of the medicine. We remember him today. So just because of their scholarly contributions, ladies and gentlemen, I want all of you to take the research as a serious task. It's not a child game. And you need to spend significant amount of time because of the fact that it's a laborious exercise. Meaning that it is like digging a small hill in order to find a small stone. As simple as that, ladies and gentlemen. So meaning that the small stone can be Kohinoor diamond. Marie Curie, when she was doing her master's degree, her supervisor abused her, and her supervisor told her that you are doing all the rubbish research work. But with that kind of determination, that kind of, you know, strong faith in herself and in her research, she never gave up. She went on doing the research, a credible research. That's how she became a popular researcher. And so, ladies and gentlemen, we must take the research. If you respect the research, research also will respect you back. And you will, one day we are all going to leave. In the coming 50 to 70 years time, nobody is sitting here on this platform. They're not going to be alive. That is the fact of the matter. But your research will make you alive. So with this, a few remarks from my side, I'd like to thank the conference organizers for giving me this opportunity. And so I wish you all the best in the coming 1 week. Thank you, Anna.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving really the deep insights about the research and giving the insights that is really wonderful on your side, that leader may or may not be identified, but the researcher and his work will definitely be identified forever. And you have really given a deep insights to our research scholars, to the emerging research scholars, and really they have to work hard. Recent times, this doctoral degree, sometimes people are really taking it very casually, and they are not putting up their 100% on it. So the time is again, talk about the quality, time is again, which is actually focusing on the quality work. And quality never comes like in a very easy way. It needs a lot of dedication. It needs a lot of attention, concentration. And that is why the Tagore University, and also in collaboration this time with Oro University Surat and Hamidiya Arts and Commerce College, really making such kind of gatherings again and again, just to give the recall, as we all like, I think Rohit sir is from marketing, so we know the brand recall value. We know about that recalling aspect, that wherever, again and again, when we put a thrust on the consumer mind, and as well as the economic professors are also there. So when we put a again and again hit on the consumer mind, he or she always think upon the product and think upon the various characteristics of the product. Similarly, if we come forward with such kind of workshops wherein we have a galaxy of intellects to share their words of wisdom, to share their experience, innate experience, to share the, sometimes things are read between the lines. Scholars have to understand what you and what honorable other VCs also they have addressed is about, that there's no shortcut to research, which I can extract from my side, from this total, you can say the delivery, which we have recently. Also, they also have to understand that how we have to go further with this research process, and a long way to go, but we are trying to make it easy. We are trying to make it comfortable with the due support of the eminent personas like you and the honorable vice chancellors who have shared their learnings before you. So I think this is from our side in the inaugural session. Further, we will be having a session of Dr. Kavita Indapurkar, but before that, seeing the occupancy of our honorable vice chancellor sir also, and seeing I think you must also be having certain other assignments too, I request Dr. Deepthi Maheshwari, Dean, Faculty of Commerce, and the Editor-in-Chief, Shodayatan Journal, UGC Journal, Rabindranath Tagore University, to please propose the formal vote of thanks to the our eminent guest of the inaugural session. Madam, are you there?
Yes, ma'am. I am here. Thank you. Thank you, Sangeeta ma'am. Good evening to all dignitaries and eminent speaker, and all deans, HOD, and dear participants. It's my privilege to have been asked to propose vote of thanks in this inaugural session of short-term training program on research and innovation using technology, organized by Faculty of Humanities, Commerce, Management, Rabindranath Tagore University, and Oro in association with Oro University Gujarat and Hamidiya Arts and Commerce College, Bhopal. I would like to propose heartfelt thanks to our keynote speaker, Dr. Professor Ravindra Raina sir, for delivering and enlightening us for your thought-provoking address. And this was the excellent address, sir. Thank you so much. And I extended to my gratitude to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Professor Bhram Prakash Petia, sir, for his support and guidance. And also I am thankful to Vice Chancellor, sir, Professor Rajan Velukar sir, Oro University, for his thought-provoking address. Sir has given a very good insight regarding the research and research projects. And I am also thankful to PK Jain sir, Principal Government Art and Hamidia College Bhopal, for his wishing, for his wishes. And I am also thankful to Dr. Dean Rohit sir, to Dean Faculty of Management, Dr. Rohit sir, from Oro University, for his support and guidance. And I am also thankful to all deans and HODs from Rabindranath Tagore University. Without his support, we can't do organize this type of short-term training programs. And I am also thankful to all participants, because without all the participant support, we can't successfully organize this type of program. I hope these 2 days, matlab, these 7 days are very fruitful to all research scholar. So I wish these research journey will be fruitful to all of you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Deepti ma'am. So now, as we have formally wrapped up the inaugural session, now we are proceeding further with our first expert session of this short-term training program titled Research and Innovation Using Technology. I can see Dr. Kavita ma'am, are you there?
Yeah. Thank you. May I leave now? Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wishes, sir.
Thank you very much. Best of luck.
Thank you, sir. So, Dr. Kavita ma'am, are you there?
Yes, absolutely, madam.
Okay. So, so before ma'am proceed with her first session that we have taken as the identification of research problem, identification of research problem is itself is a very big problem, and till the submission of the synopsis, it is really very difficult to identify the same, and then changes come across in that. But before proceeding further, Kavita ma'am, please permit me to share your very small credentials with the audience. Dr. Kavita Indapurkar, having an experience of teaching in higher education institution in India over 23 years, she has held several academic leadership positions and is presently serving as a professor and joint administrator in the School of Economics, MIT University, Noida campus. She is PhD in economics and an MBA, and has also acquired NET and SLET degrees. She finds her research interest at the crossroads of behavioral aspects of people. Maybe it about how do they formulate inflationary expectations, or how do they decide to plan for their retirement, etc. So far, she has 8 scholars under her working in the areas like financial literacy, inflationary expectations, financial inclusion, retirement, and cultural economics. So in short, I can say that she has touched upon the various facets of economics as justifying the economics professor. She has number of publications in Scopus Index Journal and Web of Science. She has been the member of Board of Studies and external member for research development in few universities. And she is very actively taking the sessions in the research workshop, and as well as also in the workshop, the titled on the outcome-based education. Recently, she has also delivered one session in one of the workshop on outcome-based education. So I hope that with this approach, and presently she's working on one project that is funded by ICSSR. As in person, I personally know her. She is a core researcher talking about the in-depth understanding of the subject matter. And as I was saying that she believes in outcome-based education, I'm sure her present session, this session on problem identification, the first step of research process, we all know about it. But again, as I said, that it is really a very big problem to find out the real problem for the research. So I hope that the outcome of this first session will be that at least the researcher will have an insight about the problem identification. Further also, I will just update one thing, that as this program is of 7 days, tomorrow there will be no session. There's a break of 1 day. It's of 2 reasons. We have certain preoccupied meetings and other things line up on the same timeline. So the slot is not free for us tomorrow, 23rd. Another thing which I think is that at least we are giving you 1 day breaks time to think about the some problems if you have in your mind to proceed further with the research, so that the session on 24th April, which will be talking about the citation management using WebMendeley, in which the initial discussion will be on the literature review, you will be able to focus on your identified problem if you can identify or if you can reinforce in your mind after this session. Remember, dear participants, as we are talking about, this is a training program. The success of this program purely depends on your participation, on your concentration, and on your attention. So, Kavita ma'am, the platform is for you now to proceed with the session.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sangeeta, and thank you for the kind words of introducing me. Let us proceed now with the identification of the problem. So this is because all the, research is undertaken, actually all research is undertaken with problem at its center. So therefore, it is very important that we identify the problem. Now, when we are talking about research in humanities, social sciences, arts, liberal arts, management, it is important that we understand that research is basically for the generation of new knowledge. So something which is new needs to be generated in the process of research. It helps in exploration of new phenomena. Whenever new knowledge is generated, new phenomena is explored. And in the process of determining the new phenomena or exploring the new phenomena, we try to come out with the solutions. We generate solutions to whatever new phenomena that have been undertaken. Now, when new solutions are generated, their efficacy needs to be measured. Now, just saying that a new problem is generated and therefore a new solution has been suggested is not sufficient. We need to check with the efficacy of the new solutions that have been generated. So again, research. So I'm here just trying to tell you that how we start from research and then again we end up to research only. So when we go for learning or knowing about the efficacy of the solutions which are generated, then we also explore that how successfully the solutions can be implemented in the real world. And what are the reasons for the successful implementation or what are the reasons for unsuccessful implementations? So again, research, right? So in this way, an in-depth view of whatever are the shortfalls, studied with the help of research, and with that we can improve further. Now, similarly, this goes well with the business related decisions also. So we start with something called a new knowledge, and then we explore it further. We develop the solutions to the problem, newly developed problems. We find the efficacy of the problem, of the solutions. And then, look for what are the shortfalls. And then finally, we try to understand that how well the solutions can be taken further. Now, this goes with businesses also. And it is only with the help of research that better planning, better controlling, better implementation of various actions can be taken. So I have heard, you all must have heard eminent people speaking in the inaugural session, who were talking about so many great inventions and innovations that have taken place and that are going to take place. For example, robo dog and a robotic arm and all these things. But there is central to everything is a problem. A problem is identified first. For example, loneliness. Now, loneliness was probably identified as a problem, and as a solution to that loneliness is that RoboDog which was created. So, the problem, the central problem needs to be identified, and research helps us to apply better control mechanisms so that better implementation happens. More effective and efficient implementation of the things happen. Now, when we are talking about humanities, social sciences, arts, and so on and so forth, what our idea is not to our aim, or you can say that our responsibility is not to create that artificial hand, or it is not to create that artificial intelligence, but it is to see that how people are affected using these. So we are into understanding the approach, the behavior of the people, or the outcome of the successful implementation of, or a successful coming out of a new product. So how people are behaving, how they are able to use the new product, how well have they solved their problems with the help of the new product. So all these things is the kind of research that we as the students of economics, students of social sciences, or students of management would be taking care of. So our research would also revolve definitely around the problem. And that problem identification gives an idea of who is the end user of the research results. So this is also important that we understand these stakeholders. Who is the end user? Stakeholders, this was also talked about, where one of our professors, I mean, in person, spoke about the stakeholders, that who will be using this research? The policymakers, or those on whom the policy will be implemented, or those who will be funding. So all these are the stakeholders. So we have to see that the problem identification has to be in such a way that the end users are well known to us. Then accordingly, the research design has to be formulated, and the variables are to be identified so that we get a framework to work in constraints. So basically, there are two types of constraints. One is the time constraint and the other is the money constraint. So if you are a PhD scholar and you are undertaking some research project as a part of your thesis, or you are doing some PhD, so it means that time is also a constraint for you and money is also a constraint for you. So accordingly, you will be formulating a research problem. Now, considering that you all are almost all the participants who are here in this particular webinar are actually those who are interested in conducting a research for their as an academic research. So there are certain steps. Now, I have divided this into seven steps. If you really want to come out with some useful research, although how small it may be, it is not necessary that you have very big objective. It is not necessary that you have very, 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 very widespread objective. You can have a very small objective, very pinpointed area, and then also you can have a wonderful research to undertake. Only the thing is, most importantly, the research should be in the area which interests you. That is the first condition. If you are not interested in that particular subject or area, research cannot be undertaken. Because before anything else, research is something which is very creative in nature. So, research, I cannot say that you conduct a research because this is a very burning area and it will give you a lot of scope in getting things published. So work in this particular area, don't go for it. You should only identify, first of all, your interest. So please, it is a humble request to each one of you sitting here that whenever you want to do research, please do not take up any topic just because your guide is interested in it, or just because this topic is very hot right now and it would be a cakewalk if you do it, because a lot of material is available in this. Please, you identify a broad field or subject area which is of interest to you. So this is the first step. Now, suppose if you are studying economics, so when you are, suppose you are a student of economics, or you are a student of history, or you are a student of geography, or you are a student of Hindi, Hindi literature, English literature. So you have to dissect your area, and then you will have to understand that what further interests you. So for example, if you are a student of economics, you might be interested in researching about consumption decisions. Now, someone might say that consumption decision is something related to consumer theory. Now, consumer theory is also management. Consumer theory is also economics, right? Consumer theory is also related to behavior. Okay, so you have to have variety of dissection of the topics. For example, you can talk about the satisfaction of the people. You might be interested in profiling the satisfied customers. You might be interested in finding out the reasons why they are satisfied. You might be interested in knowing that what is the role of demonstration effect upon them, right? So just out of this consumption decision, there might be several such broad areas which can be dissected further. These are some of the broad sub areas, right? Which you can dissect further, right? So this is the first thing. After you decide, now in India, generally what happens is that whatever you have done your master's in, you are allowed to do your PhD in that only. Right. So it is already decided that the subject or area of your interest is the one which you have taken in your master's. But now you can take up certain multidisciplinary issues, and you can combine together, join together various history and economics. You can combine Hindi literature, English literature, and maybe management. So there can be a multidisciplinary research, and nowadays multidisciplinary research is the need of the hour. So you can identify some of the topics that interest you, which are multidisciplinary in nature, and you should go for it. Now, when I say you should go for it, that doesn't mean that you have to sacrifice upon your interest. You have to see that what is your area of interest, right? That is primary. So you dissect the broad area into sub areas, and you try to come out with some multidisciplinary approach to any kind of topic. So I have taken this as example purposely, because here it is not only that I'm talking about customers. So when I talk about customers, it becomes management. When I talk about satisfaction, it becomes management, because economics only talks about utility. They do not talk about satisfaction. So, but here, management talks about satisfaction. So, but now this the fourth thing is demonstration effect. This is purely economics, right? Then similarly, choice. Now, making choices is again economics. Making choices is again management also. So, what I want to say here is you have to read. You cannot dissect into sub areas unless and until you read a lot. So the first and the foremost thing that a researcher has to keep in mind is that they have to read. Reading, ardent reader can be a good researcher. Can be, I'm saying, not necessarily, but an ardent reader can be a very good researcher also, because you are required to apply whatever you have read creatively to your area of interest. It has to be applied very creatively. Right now, after you are dissecting, after you have dissected the broad area into various sub areas, then you select the topic as per the gap identified. Now let us understand what is this gap. Now this gap is actually when I'm talking about gap, this is actually the research gap. Right now, it is neither advisable nor feasible to study all the sub areas. So you have to choose any one of the sub areas, but you have to choose on the basis of the research gaps. Now, what do you mean by a research gap? research gap is something which is identified only on the basis of lot of review, lot of studies that you have gone through in that particular area to see that what all has been undertaken by researchers, by various researchers within the country and outside the country, and then where you can fit in or pitch in your area of study that can lead to or that can add to the existing pool of knowledge. Now, this is very important that you do not have to take up a research which is already done. You cannot do that. You cannot come up with a research that is already there in place. Why? Because if you are replicating something again, it is of no use. It is not adding to the existing body of knowledge. So therefore, it is important that you identify the gap. Now, the best way to identify the gap is to go through the research that has already been undertaken. Go through the Google Scholar, go through Shodh Ganga, go through Scopus indexed papers. In those Scopus papers, you will come to know that what so many kinds of research have been undertaken. And all those research are not done in India. Most of the researchers are either not done in India, so you find a gap there, right? Like, for example, one of my scholars was working on the financial literacy. So we found that there is dearth of good research in the area of financial literacy as far as India is concerned. Although a lot of studies are there elsewhere, but not in India, right? Then you can even choose the that particular niche population over whom you are going to study. For example, a lot of studies are there on at the very lower level of the lower end of the customers, or in that spectrum of population, which is very low income. So OECD has done a lot on understanding the financial literacy for those people who have very, very, very few annas in income. So they are not even having a good bank account or something like that. And then they were trying to understand the financial literacy in terms of knowing whether they should go to bank, financial literacy in terms of knowing whether one should save in their own purse or they should save in bank. So that is the level, that was the level that was used by OECD, right? But not much was done among the middle income group, right? So this is called the spectrum of population on which the studies are done. So how far the studies are conducted in the middle income group, how far the studies are done on the high income group. So a lot of studies were done on very low income group, but definitely very few studies were done in middle income group. So this is a gap. So this you cannot find out unless and until you read. So again, reading becomes very, very important in order to identify the gaps. Now, when you identify the gap, you can identify the gap on two, three things. One is the time period also. Sometimes studies are not done before and after the occurrence of certain phenomena. Now, this COVID-19 can pose to be one of the important phenomena. So, post-pandemic, pre-pandemic, so there will be a lot of requirement of research literature with respect to post-pandemic issues, the mental issues associated, well-being associated with the people, work from home, and the problems and challenges faced by women in post-pandemic or during the pandemic. So these are this new phenomena. So this is about the timeline. So this gap will remain there, is going to remain there for a long time. So the researchers can make very good use of this, right? So in this way, the gap can be identified. And then there are certain concepts, they can be taken together. And if those concepts are not taken together till that can also create a kind of a gap. For example, again, suppose I say financial literacy and financial planning. So these are the two concepts that go together generally. So if the financial literacy is high, the financial literacy is higher. So it is a general understanding. So, but has it been done in India? Are the people, is it true for Indian population? Is it true for the Indian middle income group? Is it the same for all the, demographic profiles? So this can be again, a gap can be identified over here. So in this way, there are many ways in which the gap can be identified. So timeline, then the various constructs, then geographical location. These are some of the important gaps that can be looked for as far as your research is concerned. Then accordingly, a topic is selected by you. Now, topic is not the title, students. It is just a topic. Now, title should come only at the end. Now, when once the topic is identified, then we have to see that jisko kehte hain thok baja ke dekhna ki whether we are up to this, will we be able to do it or not. That is very important, right? Because there is a lot of enthusiasm among people when they decide about a topic, and then later on it becomes very, very difficult to go ahead with the same topic. So we have to see that we raise the research questions based on whatever topic is selected. And suppose I keep these as the some of the broad areas, and then I go on raising the research questions. So what are the segments of consumers that are more satisfied? What are key factors or reasons that led to their satisfaction levels? What has led to choose the product? What is the impact of demonstration effect of using the product, right? So all these things can be, there is various research questions. Now, here you can see that how a research idea can be converted into various research questions. So suppose I have a research idea which is based upon the consumption of nutritious food among the rural population. Then I can have these research questions. Are the people aware about the importance of nutritious food? Is there any influence of education on their level of awareness? Has increase in income led to the choice of buying nutritious food? Is female education improved the health consciousness among the rural people in general? Has nudging about strong immunity during pandemic put any influence in choice making of rural poor? So all these are the research questions that can be raised. Similarly, if we want to have a research idea, if you have a research idea that what is the problem faced by children of migrants during COVID-19, so we can have research questions based on that. So in this way, for one research idea, you can have large number of research questions, right? You can have many more. I have given you just in one example that how can you have large number of questions. Now, on the basis of the questions, the objectives can be formulated depending upon the type of objectives or the type of research that you want to undertake. Your objectives are actually carved out of the research questions, and objectives are put more formally than the research questions. So now what research questions are? Actually, research questions are those which are asked by the researcher to himself, that if he undertakes the research, then what are the kinds of answers which he will be getting out of the research? But on the basis of the research questions, more formal research objectives need to be formulated. And, these research objectives are formal and they need to be achieved at the end of the research. All research questions need not be, all answers to all the research questions need not be obtained from one research. You might need 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 types of research to get the answers to all the research questions, right? So research questions can be large in number. Out of those research questions, you can identify or decide to take up certain research questions in the form of objectives to carry out one of your research. And later on, you can say that remaining research questions, I will try to undertake in separate research or separate, research endeavor. So it will not be clubbed together. So let us now try to understand the research questions and how they can be paraphrased into research objectives. Now, research questions, for example, are the people aware about the importance of nutritious food? So this is a research question. So you can convert it into a research objective by saying that to bring out the level of awareness about nutritious food among the population under study. Is there any influence of education on the level of awareness? So we can put it across as an objective to study the association of education and awareness among the respondents. Third, has increase in income led to the choice of buying nutritious food? So we can have the objective to assess the role of female education on the level of awareness about nutritious foods among the population under study. So similarly, has nudging about strong immunity during pandemic put any influence in choice or influence in choice making of the rural? So here we are trying to identify or assess the role of nudging during the present pandemic in the study area, right? So in this way, we can have lot of research questions. Out of these research questions, you can decide to convert a few research questions into research objectives for your present study, right? So any research idea and a large number of research questions should give you at least 2 to 3 ideas for different research papers or research projects or research articles. It is generally that is. So one research idea should generate at least 3 to 4 types of different, research papers or ideas for research papers. Now, when you are writing the research objectives, you have to be very careful that you are, having a complete information, giving a complete information. And you are starting with the term TO2 to describe, to find out, to ascertain, right? And then the impact of training on employee retention in the given area or among the people of a particular organization, or we are talking about the 5-star hotels. Are we talking about the employees in the medical facilities of a particular country? So all these things, we have to be very, very clear. We need to demonstrate, to ascertain, to compare. So all these are the examples. We have to be very careful when we are formulating the objectives. Now, if I see this first, to bring out the level of awareness among the nutritious food, about the nutritious food among the population under study. So this is a complete information, right? The complete information about the objective with which we are undertaking this particular research. Now, after this, when we are done with our objectives, we should examine our objectives once again. We have to see that whether we will be able to achieve the objectives in terms of time and in terms of resource constraint. We have to see the constraint in terms of financial constraints also and human constraints also. So we have to cross-check with our objectives and and then the technical expertise that is available at our disposal. And definitely, with the technical expertise should be, we should aim at improving it further. But then we should definitely look for the various constraints that we might have. And depending upon the constraints, we have to finally select the objectives. So once again, I always recommend that you should give a double check that whether you are really interested in this particular study. Do you agree with the objectives that you will be able to achieve it in the given time and given resources? Do you have adequate resources? And do you have adequate technical expertise to undertake the study? If you have that, then only then you should take these as objectives. And on the basis of the objectives, then you should finalize the title. So this is how you should undertake the problem identification and then proceed with your research. So thank you so much. I will be happy to answer the questions.
Thank you, Kavita ma'am. Stop. You can stop your share screen so that we can have a better view. I have already mentioned in the chat box, like if the participants, if they have any feedback or they have any question to raise. To summarize this session, as we always say that the research begins with the question. We should have a lot of questions in our mind before proceeding for the research. And there are a number of questions which comes in our mind. You can call it about as a curiosity also. So they can share their questions in the group. If you have any question, if any researcher or any participant or any faculty, I think Dr. Basanti ma'am have shared one statement, I think, or maybe it is a kind of question. Choose a topic that you are passionate about. Make sure, just a minute, I'll read it out. Meanwhile, Monica ma'am, would you like to say something on this? So you can please proceed, or Rohit sir, or any of the teacher panelists.
So, I think Kavita ma'am has simplified everything so beautifully that I think it makes research very easy now. It's sounding easy. Because generally, you know, we all have burnt our hands at the time when we did PhD and we knew the challenges. And I think I wish and hope that that time also, if there would be extended sessions like this, the impact would have been very different what we have done today. So,
thank you.
Ma'am, one question is there in my mind. Like I was just thinking, generally, you know, in PhD program, when we frame the objectives based on the research questions, so scholars always keep in mind that should we go by a number of limited number of objectives, or should we go by 10 or 15 objectives, or should we limit ourselves to 3 or 4 objectives? So because this is one notion which actually comes in the mind, because generally I think it depends, maybe one research objective will actually meet the outcome of your research. I think that's a big thing. So what do you want to say on this with respect to the number of objectives? that's very important part, which I feel.
I think a very nice question, first of all, because this is very dynamic. The answer has to be very dynamic. I just can't say that 4 objectives, I mean, or 15 objectives. This is not possible, because it is quite possible that you are having only one objective. And then on that one objective, you have certain derived objectives.
Sub-objectives. Yeah.
So there can be derived objectives also. For example, if suppose I say that I want to profile the those customers who are satisfied customers. So when I talk about profiling, I will also be wanting to find out that what are the reasons because of which they are satisfied. So, there are certain objectives which are absolutely way apart from each other, whereas there are certain objectives which are coupled with, the similar concepts. Similarly, there can be objectives in which there are more than 2 constructs at the same time. So, I think that in any research, at least these 3 types of objectives should be there, in which you have one objective which is regarding a particular phenomena. There can be another which is regarding the interface or interlinkage between the 2 constructs of the phenomena. And then there can be a third which is a derived objective. So that way it can be defined. And then, yes, of definitely fourth objective can be about the policy implications and related to that.
Yeah.
So I think three objectives are sufficient, 3 to 4 objectives.
Yes, yes. Because, you know, at the initial stage of research, these clarities are very important, that what is going to be your topic of your thesis and what are going to be your objectives and then the derived objectives, as you rightly said. Because if you don't have clarity in that, it is difficult to demarcate. And then our research also diverts. Yeah. Over a period of time, because the topic is not aligned to objectives, and
that is very important that we have to. So topic, the title should be finalized at the end.
Absolutely.
Once the objectives are finalized, only then the title has to be finalized, not before that. Only topic can be identified first, and then we can go on looking for the research questions and finalizing the objectives. Mm-hmm. And after we finalize the objectives, we can go back and finalize our title.
Absolutely. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
thank you, Kavita, ma'am. So I'll be taking one question of Sonal Shah. But before that, I'll be coming forward with a very common statement for all the participants. Like when we talk about the subject matter, Kavita, ma'am, or Munka, ma'am. So I think those who are enrolling themselves in the PhD program, the research scholars, we call. We actually assume it, like we always take an hypothesis, whether in any of the field it is. So the subjective knowledge is, I think, is sufficient enough, which is with the scholar. The point is that how that subjective knowledge can be taken into the research way or can be taken as in the research form. So because of that, all these things are being served to the research scholars and the research fraternity, so that you should have an angle of research to it. Subjective knowledge, we all get the subjective knowledge at the PG level. Like for an example, if somebody wants to work on cryptocurrency. So cryptocurrency is something, a new kind of virtual currency, which is coming in. Now, and the scholar comes up with that. So cryptocurrency never is a part of our subject so far, but now, if it is there, and as a student of maybe finance or as a student of maybe economics, I want to get into the in-depth analysis of the same. So I have to understand the research dimensions. So this is my message to all the participants, that if you have the in-depth understanding of particular, that's what madam is saying, is topic, and you want to explore that topic, you want to get into the depth of that topic. So that topic selection is always by the scholar. Then only we consider you that you are, first of all, eligible enough to be a researcher. And then the research dimension is being given by the eminent mentors, guides, and the other expert members. And then the way forward to conduct the research in that particular discipline. So this is the common answer to the all the participants who are listening to us today and getting the insights of the research. There's one question from Sonal Shah. How we can explore in the field of IT because it's growing very fast. So how we should go for this field and how we can select the problem in this area. Kavita ma'am, can you answer on it? How we can explore in the field of IT?
IT?
IT, yeah, information technology.
IT. Okay.
Yeah, because it is growing very fast.
Now, for example, if we are talking about information technology, so I would like to say that information technology is something which is a kind of a phenomena, for example. Okay, so information technology, use of information technology, and you can take up various management related issues, or you can take up information technology, how it has changed the lives of the people, how it has changed the lives in the organization, how or you can say that how the problems are solved and what problems are created. So, because ultimately any research has to be around some problem. So the problem has to be understood in the sense that if we are using IT, for example, I think there was some eminent speaker who was saying that we are satisfied with, when we are having a WhatsApp call. So our urge to meet that person gets satisfied. So that emotional, connect is there. And so online classes, for example, have there in this way helped us, because they have actually saved us from the virus, because we were able to with the help of IT only we were able to give impart education, take by education, learn something, and but there are many other aspects of using this IT, right? So we have to understand if we want to take up this in management, or we want to take up this in education, or we want to take up this in team building, leadership. So in all these areas, this IT can be, I think, can be this is a very new, Sangeeta ma'am, can be a very new area, like how leadership leaders are able to keep their teams together with the help of this this IT mechanism, or how the organizations are able to keep with the consumers in with this IT. So in this way, we have to broaden our view and then look for the problem, and surrounding that problem, then we can develop the questions and go for our study.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. So adding it to this, definitely this is a present era wherein things are drastically changing. But again, we always say that research is not always about, we are talking about something new in a way. But yes, research is always to justify the existing mechanism or to find out the gap in that. So definitely, as I said before your answer also, that the subject or the topic or the area which appeals me the most is, first of all, is the research arena to work with, followed by the gap which you said, that if we have a gap in that, like for an example, sir has given us a deep insight, Honorable Vice Chancellor, that, and this question also came in my mind as a person of economics, that when the how about the productive generation, when you talk about the youth and the young generation, and still the vaccination we started with the mature group of age. And there are such kind of things which really wants to be explored, and how much this IT intervention again is having its deep roots in various areas. So, and now, as I always believe, when I was coining this program, Monica ma'am, some engineering people, science people were asking me, madam, how it will be useful for us. So now I again request, I keep a urge on this platform, try to break this monotony. हिंदी वाला पर्सन मुझसे पूछता है कि ये जो प्रोग्राम है मैडम, ये मेरे लिए कैसे यूजफुल है. ये सवाल ही बताता है कि हमने अपने आसपास कितनी दीवारें खड़ी कर दी हैं. अगर हम शोध की बात करते हैं, रिसर्च की बात करते हैं, हम एज अ टीचर, हम एज अ गाइड, हम एज अ स्कॉलर, सबसे पहले हमें ये वॉल्स ब्रेक करनी है, जो ऑनरेबल वाइस चांसलर ने भी मुझे हमें बताया. हम बहुत बात करते हैं मल्टी डिसिप्लिनरी, इंटर डिसिप्लिनरी, ट्रांस डिसिप्लिनरी, बट ये फोरम है जहां मैं अपने दिल की बात भी रखूंगी. हम इसे सिर्फ बोलते हैं, हम इसको फॉलो नहीं करते. हिंदी बिना टेक्नोलॉजी के आज कुछ भी नहीं है. हमारे साथ यहाँ पर हिंदी के भी प्रोफेसर जुड़े हुए हैं, मेरे खुद के दिमाग विभाग के, और वो भी जानते हैं कि आज की डेट में अगर हम लैंग्वेज की बात करें, और आज भी नहीं, पहले भी अगर लैंग्वेज था तो टेक्नोलॉजी थी. फोनेटिक्स की आप बात करें तो उस पर टेक्नोलॉजी थी. तो आप पहले ये जो एयर टाइट कंपार्टमेंट्स हैं, जब तक ये रिसर्चर ये कंपार्टमेंट नहीं तोड़ेगा, तब तक जो रिसर्च है वो मीनिंगफुल नहीं आएगी. वो आएगी लेकिन वो वेग होगी. दूसरा, वो कंपार्टमेंट के उसे खुद की उसकी जो क्यूरोसिटी है, वो खुद जब तक चीजें नहीं ढूंढेगा. ये सारे प्रोग्राम्स, ये सारे वर्कशॉप्स एक दिशा निर्देश के लिए होते हैं, एक मार्गदर्शन के लिए होते हैं. ये रिकन्फर्म करने के लिए होते हैं कि जो आप सोच रहे हैं वो सही है, या उसमें कुछ और ऐड या डिलीट करने की जरूरत है. तो आप रिसर्चर हैं, अगर सब कुछ आपको कहीं और से मिल जाएगा, सो आई थिंक ये जो वर्ड है रिसर्चर, हम इसको जस्टिफाई नहीं कर पाएंगे, क्योंकि मैं रिसर्चर हूं, मुझे ढूंढना है बस. मुझे जो वो दिशा है, जो अभी मोनिका मैम कह रही थी कि हैड इट बीन हमें पता पड़ जाता, या कोई हमें बता देता कि इतने ऑब्जेक्टिव सफिशिएंट हैं, या कोई हमें बता देता कि ऑब्जेक्टिव्स के साथ कितने हाइपोथेसिस होने चाहिए, या हाइपोथेसिस होने चाहिए या नहीं होने चाहिए, ये सारे सवालों के जवाब जो हमने बहुत मुश्किलों से ढूंढे हैं, जो अब जो जनरेशन है उसको हम कोशिश कर रहे हैं सर्व करने की. रविंद्र रैना सर हमारे साथ हैं, वो बता रहे हैं लोगों को कि आप किस तरह से किस दिशा में जाइए. तो शायद वी ऑल आर दैट फ्रॉम दैट जनरेशन. आई थिंक दीप्ति मैडम इज देयर, उषा मैडम, ऑल ऑफ वी आर फ्रॉम द सेम जनरेशन वेर इन वी स्ट्रगल्ड हार्ड टू एटलीस्ट फाइनलाइज अवर प्रॉब्लम, अ टॉपिक और टाइटल, व्हाटएवर यू से. But now with the blessing of technology, with the blessing of all these programs, at least we are there to support you, to start your research, to support you, to move into the same direction and again to reconfirm that, am I going in the right direction? So that you can ask your mentor, that you can ask your guide, that you can ask your subject expert. But believe me, the thing you only have to start, the thing only you have to think on, we are there as a guide, as a mentor, and as an expert to support you in that regard. One question is from Dr. Basanti, ma'am. It comes very, very frequently. This is covering, I think, both scholar and guide. Choosing a topic that you are passionate about, as you said, make sure to search for a topic that interests you. Follow your professor's advice, but make your own choices. It's a very big question. So I think, Basanti, ma'am, can you unmute yourself and can you express your feelings for this? What you are actually talking about this? Like, Basanti, ma'am, you are in panel.
Madam, ye question. Yeah, ma'am. Ma'am, ye question to sare guide ki taraf se hi hai.
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल, आप गाइड की तरफ से भी बात कर सकते हैं, ये प्रोग्राम दोनों के लिए. तो इसका आंसर कविता मैम बताइए. इसका
पहले 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 क्वेश्चन हो जाए
जी. बिल्कुल मैडम, आप अपनी भावनाएं बताएं तो फिर कविता मैडम अपना आंसर बताएंगी.
मैडम, भावनाएं तो यही है कि एज ए स्कॉलर टॉपिक लेकर आते हैं, फिर उस टॉपिक पे ही वो बर्डन रहता है कि नहीं मैडम, हमें इसमें ही सारी चीजें मिल गई हैं, हमें सारा डाटा मिल गया है. इस टाइम ऐसा होता है जब थीसिस लिखने का टाइम आता है तो भाई ये टॉपिक थोड़ा सा उससे रिलेटेड डाटा नहीं मिल पा रहा है, तो ये वाली प्रॉब्लम इसमें सबसे ज्यादा साइड प्रॉब्लम क्रिएट करती है.
देखिए, जब भी स्टूडेंट्स, जब भी रिसर्चर से बात होगी तब यही कहा जाएगा कि रिसर्चर को अपना जो उसको पसंद है उसे करना है, क्योंकि अल्टीमेटली ये उसका रिसर्च है. yeah. हमारा और आपका नहीं है. हमारा और आपका केवल गाइडेंस है, दिशा. हम केवल दिशा दे सकते हैं कि भाई इस तरफ चले जाओ, देखो इस साइड तुम्हें बहुत कुछ मिल जाए, इस तरफ चले जाओ, तुम ये वाली किताब पढ़ लो, ये लाइब्रेरी में चले जाओ, ये वाला वर्कशॉप अटेंड करो, इससे यू विल गेट हर एक चीज की इंफॉर्मेशन, हर एक चीज. इसीलिए दिस इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन अ टीचर एंड अ गाइड. ये स्टूडेंट्स को भी समझना पड़ेगा क्योंकि वो स्टूडेंट नहीं, स्कॉलर है. इसीलिए हम कहते हैं स्टूडेंट और टीचर और स्कॉलर और गाइड, ये डिफरेंस आ जाता है उसमें, पहली बात. दूसरी बात, सब कुछ मिल गया है ऐसा नहीं हो सकता. सब कुछ मिल गया इसका मतलब गैप नहीं है. आपको एज अ गाइड उसको बोलना होगा, मुझे दिखाओ कहां पर रिसर्च गैप है, कहां पर गैप है इसके अंदर. अगर ये रिसर्च ऑलरेडी हो रखी है तो फिर तुम इसमें क्या करोगे नया, क्योंकि रिसर्च का मतलब है कुछ नया ऐड करना. यदि वो कुछ भी नया ऐड नहीं कर रहा तो वो रिसर्च नहीं कर रहा, वो केवल एक रिप्लिकेट कर दे रहा है ऑलरेडी एग्जिस्टिंग चीज को, फिर से एक बार लिख दे रहा है. पहले इंग्लिश में लिखा था, अभी हिंदी में लिख देगा, या तेलुगु में लिखा था, अभी मलयालम में लिख देगा. नो, सो वी हैव टू बी वेरी वेरी क्लियर दैट यू गो बाय व्हाट यू लाइक, बट गिव अस two, three things, very important. First, show us the research gap. Second, come with the objectives and how will you achieve those objectives. आप हमें gap बताइए, आप हमें ये बताइए कि क्या objectives हैं आपके इसको करने के, किसको फायदा होगा. Ultimately, research किसी problem के ऊपर based है, and research अगर वो problem पे based है तो कोई solution लेके आएगी, वो solution से किसको फायदा होने वाला है. क्योंकि अगर वो किसी काम की नहीं है, यदि वो किसी के ही काम नहीं आने वाली है तो ना की जाए, तब फिर वो ये नहीं बोलेगा आपसे कि इसमें सब कुछ है. इसमें अगर सब कुछ है तो फिर नया क्या है, फिर तो नया है नहीं कुछ करने के लिए. सो इट शुड नॉट बी डन.
एंड वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट मैम, जनरली यू नो व्हेन वी वर पेरेंट्स, सो वी सी ड्रीम्स of ours which were unfulfilled through our children. So I think the same thing we do with our scholars also most of yes. the time. The yes. things we yes. were not able to achieve, we try yes. to achieve it through scholars.
Through
but
scholars.
I feel that this is very important, that I can't be confident and overconfident that this is my competency and this is my area and this is my shell and you follow me. I think it should be reverse. In fact, we need to accommodate.
It should be. He has yeah. to follow his own ideas.
Absolutely.
बट कई बार ऐसे होता है कि जो स्कॉलर है वो बिल्कुल क्लीन स्लेट आता है, ऐसे कोई बात नहीं. यदि वो क्लीन स्लेट आता है तो आप उसको बोल सकते हैं कि ये इमर्जिंग इश्यूज चल रहे हैं, ये मेरे इंटरेस्ट एरियाज हैं, इसको आप पढ़ो, ऐसे आप बोल सकते हो. बहुत सारे स्कॉलर्स आएंगे आपके पास जो बिल्कुल क्लीन स्लेट होते हैं.
यस
ठीक है, तो हम ऐसे भी कर सकते हैं. लेकिन अल्टीमेटली वो उस स्कॉलर से हमें कहलवाना है कि हाँ मैं इस एरिया में इंटरेस्टेड हूँ.
Absolutely. Sangeeta ma'am, I know we are short of time, but it's a very good technical question.
No, ma'am. I think we are not at all short of time.
Okay, fine. So, Sangeeta is the best. Interesting question.
जितने questions आएंगे ma'am, उतना effective है कि हमको समझ आया. क्योंकि वहाँ सवाल नहीं, वहाँ research नहीं.
Yeah. So there's a very important question by one of my colleague, Dr. Chivukula Ramana from Oregon University.
Yes, I've seen that.
He's also the program coordinator of PhD of Oregon University School of Business. So, ma'am, you can read his question so that.
Yes, ma'am. I'm reading out that. Yes, so, from Ramana, sir, because I personally know sir is also having keen interest on research. So, from Ramana, sir, the question is, some journals are insisting on empirical analysis when research problem, research question, and objectives are mentioned. If you plan to publish a conceptual paper, can we use multiple case study method and achieve the same effectiveness as that of empirical analysis? Will journals accept this approach? Kavita ma'am, is the question is clear to you?
Yeah. Actually, the problem is that journal is something which is, an entity of its own. So, इफ अ जर्नल सेज कि नहीं भाई मैं तो नहीं लूंगा कोई भी जो स्टडी वो जो इम्पीरिकल नहीं है, उसमें आप और मैं कुछ नहीं कर सकते. तो जब आप एक कोई स्टडी चूज करते हैं, तब सबसे पहले जो तरीका जो जनरली कहा जाता है वो ये है कि आप जर्नल चूज कीजिए. राइट, जैसे अगर मैं हूं, सपोज मुझे एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप पे अभी इंटरेस्ट मेरा नया नया ज्यादा है, तो आई विल लुक फॉर दी जर्नल्स जो एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप पे पेपर्स पब्लिश करते हैं, और उन जर्नल्स में आई विल सी कि किस तरह के पेपर्स पब्लिश्ड हैं ऑलरेडी.
एब्सोल्युटली
राइट. और वो चार पांच जर्नल्स आप पहले आइडेंटिफाई कर लें. बहुत सारे जर्नल्स हैं जो सेम अगर ना लगाओ तो नहीं एक्सेप्ट करते पेपर, केवल फैक्टर एनालिसिस पे भी वो पेपर एक्सेप्ट नहीं करते. दे वॉन्ट कि सेम लगाई हुआ होना चाहिए. सो ये अभी जर्नल का तो हम कुछ नहीं कर सकते, लेकिन यस, क्वालिटेटिव रिसर्च इज पिकिंग अप वेरी फास्ट. And even very good journals, जो कि web of science में भी हैं, ऐसे journals, वो review of literature, जो अच्छा meta analysis वगैरह किया हुआ हो, अच्छा review paper, बिल्कुल accept करते हैं. And ऐसा नहीं है कि सारे अच्छे journals केवल empirical data पर ही जाते हैं. और case study approach से analysis करना, ये अपने आप में एक बहुत बड़ा study है, बहुत बड़ा empirical study है, छोटी study नहीं है. कोई भी case study से analysis करना is very difficult, it is not easy. So ऐसा बिल्कुल भी नहीं है. बाकी ये तो हम journal का sweet comment on the on that, this will always remain there. So it is better कि आप जो methodology use कर रहे हैं और जो topic के अराउंड आपका स्टडी है, आप उसका जर्नल पहले एक बार देख लें, कौन कौन से जर्नल्स पब्लिश कर सकते हैं आपका पेपर. दिस इज एडवाइजेबल.
ओके मैम, सो वी हैव अनदर क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम बॉबी नारायण जी, एंड ही इज आस्किंग दैट कैन वी टेक अ पर्टिकुलर पॉलिसी और बिल ऑफ गवर्नमेंट फॉर RW, दैट इज रिसर्च वर्क, लाइक से लेबर लॉ और एग्री बिल, कैन वी टेक दैट?
हाँ यस, वी कैन टेक दैट. लेकिन उसका हमारे को पहले प्रॉपर देखना, मतलब करना पड़ेगा कि हाउ हु विल बी यूजिंग दिस रिसर्च. सो ऐसा नहीं होना चाहिए कि बहुत ही छोटे आइडिया के साथ में आप उसको एज अ PhD थीसिस कर लें. सो इट शुड हैव अ वेरी कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव अप्रोच, एंड विद दैट कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव अप्रोच यू कैन डेफिनेटली टेक दिस अप, नो प्रॉब्लम इन दैट.
Yeah, in that regard, like for an example, recently we have taken work on farmer producer organization. So we are looking for the impact of that particular FPO or FPCs, which has been coined for the farmers community, for the sustainable development, so far the approach is saying. So how far it is successful, that is being checked by one of my scholars. So that way, yes, we can take any of the policy or any of the you can say framework, and we can see the impact of that framework of the maybe the community as such or on the stakeholders. So that way it can be taken further. So any other questions from participants, because we have given dedicatedly the time to the Q&A. So yes, sir, Bobby sir, we have to be a little bit like we talk about the research ethics. So in research ethics, usually we should avoid the controversies because we are the researchers. So we are not the policy makers. So whatever we have to do, we have to take care of the boundaries set it for us. So as a researcher, it is our moral duty also to follow the ethics and the integrity as such. So I think, Kavita ma'am, the question answer round. Monica ma'am, I think I've taken all the questions so far. And definitely the questions will come eventually when you will now you can say revise these things in your mind today and will think about it and will definitely think about your own respective research problem. And it may change sometimes for any of the reasons. But the one thing is very clear from this today's session is that you have to keep on thinking and you have to keep on exploring, and wherever you comes with the doubt, yes, you have to talk to mentor and guides. This from the beginning of the session of the coursework, I'm also emphasizing on the same. The question is that are we doing it? Have we started that? And if we started, how far we have gone through? Kyunki shuru karna aapka kaam hai, batana hamara kaam hai. Aur bhi jo teachers hain, jo projects par kaam karte hain, research projects par kaam karte hain, wahan par bhi कहीं ना कहीं यही बात होती है कि आप प्रोजेक्ट भी एक्सेप्टेबिलिटी पे तभी आता है जब हम किसी नए प्रोजेक्ट पे किसी नए टॉपिक पर बात करते हैं या उससे सोसाइटी की कोई ना कोई प्रॉब्लम को या तो हाईलाइट करते हैं या तो उसके लिए कोई होपफुल प्रोबेबल सॉल्यूशन देते हैं, जैसा कि हमें वीसी सर ने आज सुबह बताया और हमें उन्होंने सुझाव दिया. सो आई थिंक दिस इज द वंडरफुल सेशन कविता मैम, यू हैव गिवन टू ऑल द डियर रिसर्च स्कॉलर्स एंड ऑल्सो द टीचर्स ऑल्सो. Teachers also needs to rebrush. Sometimes we get saturated because of our own work. So this 2 hours, 1.5 hours also give us time to rethink, to redefine, and to be more creative on the research ground. So I think this is now the time to wrap up the Kavita ma'am session. So for proposing the vote of thanks to our first expert of this STTP, I request Dr. Usha Vaidya ma'am, head of the department, Faculty of Humanities and Liberal Arts, to come forward and to propose the vote of thanks to Kavita ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Sangeeta ma'am. My gratitude to all the chief guests, Honorable Chancellor sir, Professor Ravindra Raina sir, Dr. Rohit Singh sir, Professor Dr. Rajan Velukar sir. Sabhi ka main hardik dhanyavad karti hoon ki sabhi jo हमारे इस प्रोग्राम में इनका जो ग्रेसफुल अपीयरेंस रहा और इसने हमारे शॉर्ट टर्म ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम को बहुत ऊर्जा दी है. और जो एक्सपर्ट सेशन है इसमें प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर कविता इंदापुरकर मैम का भी मैं हृदय से धन्यवाद व्यक्त करती हूँ कि उन्होंने इतना अच्छा सेशन लिया. जो फर्स्ट सेशन है प्रॉब्लम आइडेंटिफिकेशन प्रोसेस इन रिसर्च, जिस पर हमारे स्टूडेंट्स या रिसर्च स्कॉलर्स बहुत कंफ्यूज होते हैं, और आपके मार्गदर्शन से उन्हें बहुत सारी जानकारियां मिली हैं, और मैं हृदय से आपका धन्यवाद व्यक्त करती हूं और बहुत सारी शुभकामनाएं भी देती हूं. आप जल्द ही स्वस्थ हों, थोड़ा आप खांस रही थी, मैं टेंशन में आ रही थी मैम, तो मेरी बहुत सारी शुभकामनाएं हैं आपको और सभी को मैं हार्दिक धन्यवाद देती हूँ. हमारे बीच डॉक्टर दीप्ति माहेश्वरी मैम डीन कॉमर्स उपस्थित हैं और डॉक्टर नेहा माथुर मैडम डीन मैनेजमेंट उपस्थित हैं, डॉक्टर संगीता जौहरी मैम डीन ह्यूमैनिटीज एंड लिबरल आर्ट्स उपस्थित हैं. तो मैं आप सभी का भी हृदय से धन्यवाद व्यक्त करती हूँ.
थैंक यू मैम.
डॉक्टर वासंती मैथ्यू मैम, HOD डॉक्टर उषा शर्मा मैम, डॉक्टर रुचि मिश्रा तिवारी मैम, डॉक्टर प्रीति श्रीवास्तव मैम, सभी का हृदय से धन्यवाद व्यक्त करती हूँ कि आप सभी की उपस्थिति ने इस प्रोग्राम को बहुत अच्छे से सफलता प्रदान की है। साथ ही साथ इस प्रोग्राम में एक महती भूमिका रही है रमन सर की, तो रमन सर को भी मैं हृदय से धन्यवाद व्यक्त करती हूँ। मिस्टर अखिलेश त्रिपाठी, मिसेस जिनी जैकब, वंदना मैम, सभी का मैं हृदय से धन्यवाद व्यक्त करती हूँ। और अगर कोई नाम छूटा हो तो उसके लिए भी मैं हृदय से धन्यवाद
व्यक्त करती हूँ। 7 दिन हर दिन हम धन्यवाद देंगे बिल्कुल
जी जी। और साथ ही साथ हमारे सभी रिसर्च स्कॉलर का जो सुबह से जिस उत्साह से मुझे बार बार मैसेज कर रहे थे, मैम मैं ज्वाइन करूँ मैं ज्वाइन करूँ, तो सभी ने ज्वाइन किया है। तो इन्हीं की प्रेजेंस से ही ये प्रोग्राम सफलता की ओर आगे बढ़ रहा है। तो सभी का हार्दिक धन्यवाद है और बहुत सारी शुभकामनाएं सभी को। सब स्वस्थ रहें, सर्वे भवन्तु सुखिनः, सर्वे संतु
निरामयाः। थैंक यू मैम। सो
मैम मोनिका मैम का नाम छूट गया है मेरे से, मोनिका मैम का भी मैं हृदय से धन्यवाद
नाम ले लिया, सो आई एम वन ऑफ देम ओनली।
थैंक यू सो मच मैम, थैंक यू
मोनिका मैम हमारे साथ ही हैं मैम। सो विद दिस थैंक यू ऑल एज मैम सेड, एंड वी विल अगेन मीट ऑन 24th ऑफ अप्रैल 2:30। टुडे थोड़ा सा टाइम कंफ्यूजन था, फॉर दैट आई एक्सटेंड एन अपोलॉजी। लेकिन वेडनेसडे को आई थिंक इट्स ऑन सैटरडे 24th अप्रैल। टुमारो इज ब्रेक डे बिकॉज टुमारो वी हैव अदर ऑक्यूपेंसी एज आई सेड। सो 24th वी विल गैदर अगेन ऑल ऑन दिस जूम प्लेटफॉर्म। वी हैव द सेपरेट व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप फॉर द पार्टिसिपेंट, सो इफ अवर कोऑर्डिनेटर्स एंड कन्वीनर्स आर गेटिंग एनी कॉल फ्रॉम द रजिस्टर्ड पार्टिसिपेंट, प्लीज एड देम इन दैट व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप। फीडबैक लिंक विल बी शेयर्ड एट द डे 7. We will be sharing the feedback link at the end of the day. And you can raise your queries in the group after the session as a decor. We have disabled the audio or video part of the participants, but you can always share your questions in the chat box and in the Q&A section. The 24th and 25th April, the session will be on the web, citation management using WebMendeley. And in that, you will be having a deep insights about this WebMendeley and how we do the literature review, how we do the citations based on that. So that will be a hands-on session. So get ready with your laptops. Do not log in with the mobile. Try to log in with the laptop. And there will be a hands-on session. And on 26th also, the session will be taken care by Chandrasekhar Vittal sir from Aurora University. So these 3 days session will be giving you a hands-on training on the WebMendeley and how you can use it effectively and how you can do your literature review with the help of the same. So thank you. Stay safe, stay happy, and join us again on 24th April, 2:30 p.m. Thank you to all and have a nice day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.